In the previous videos, we introduced chat history to our applications by adding this chat history placeholder to the prompt. And when we invoke our application, we pass a chat history array to this chat history property. And we then simply append our current user input as well as the AI response to that chat history array. And if we run this in the terminal, we do get the sense that there is some form of chat memory involved here, because we can pass information to the agent, for instance, a passphrase, and we can then ask the agent to recall that information. And because we are appending to the chat history, our application is able to retrieve that information. The issue is if we stop this conversation and let's start it again, and if I ask it again what the passphrase is, our application actually has no idea. And that is because the history is currently being stored in the session memory, and as soon as we terminate our application, all that history is lost. So what if we wanted our application to remember our conversation hours, months, weeks, or years from now? And in this video, we will solve that problem. And it's easier than you think. And because we believe in doing things the right way on this channel, I will show you two different approaches for adding memory to our chains. The first will follow a very common practice for creating these chains. And towards the end of the video, we will have a look at converting the solution into the LangChain expression language approach. Let's get started by creating a new file in the root of our project. I'll call it memory.js. And as a reminder, you can find all the source code on a GitHub repository that I will link in the description of this video. Let's start by importing our environment variables. And let's also import chat openai from LangChain/openai. And let's also import our chat prompt template. Let's instantiate our model by saying model is equal to new chat openai. Let's pass in an object with the properties model name, which is equal to GPT 3.5 turbo, as well as a temperature of 0.7. Let's also go ahead and set up our prompt by setting it equal to the chat prompt template. And let's use the .template method. And let's enter something like, you are an AI assistant. And let's add a placeholder for the user input. We can then use the LangChain expression language syntax to create our chain. So let's call chain and let's set this equal to prompt.pipe. And let's pipe in our model. Then let's invoke our chain by calling chain.invoke. And within invoke, we can pass in an object. And within this object, we need to specify the variable names that we used in this prompt template, like input. And we can assign our prompt to this, like hello there. And lately, I actually prefer to strip out this object and to assign it to its own variable. And then we can simply pass in inputs into invoke. This invoke method is asynchronous, so we need to await the response. And let's assign the response to a variable called response. And finally, let's console log response. Let's run this in the terminal just to check that this is working. And indeed, we do get our response back. So this is working. In the last two videos, we had a look at adding chat history to our chains and agents by adding a chat history variable in the prompt and then simply injecting the chat history array into this prompt. But there's actually a way more elegant way of adding memory to our applications. Let's import something from LangChain. I'll just add a comment here and call it memory imports. And let's import something from LangChain/memory. And from memory, we actually have a whole bunch of options to choose from. But in this video, we will have a look at buffer memory. Don't get worried about the name of this class though. Buffer memory does indeed mean that the messages will get lost when the session ends. But I will show you in this video how we will extend this buffer memory object to store the information in a database. And it's incredibly easy to implement. Just stick around. I sincerely believe in starting from the foundation and building our way up. So let's have a look at how we can use buffer memory to create this chat history. So just below prompt, let's create a new variable. Let's call it memory. And let's set that equal to a new instance of buffer memory. So buffer memory takes an object as input, and there's really only one property that we care about, and that is the memory key. And we can call this whatever we want. I'll simply call it history. Basically, what this class will do is we can use it to easily append messages from the conversation, and the messages that it collected will be formatted into a string and then injected into a variable in the prompt called history. So we do have to create a placeholder for this in our prompt. So just above input, let's add history, and let's create a placeholder called history as well. Now all we have to do is to somehow attach this memory object to our chain. And you would think that it is possible simply to pipe it into this somehow, but unfortunately, the memory object does not have a pipe method. So what can we do? This is where I'll show you two possible solutions. First, let's have a look at the more traditional way. I'll add a comment called using the chain classes, and I'll change this comment to using LCEL. Let's first have a look at this first option. Let's comment out this chain statement, and we'll actually use a class to create this chain. So at the top of our code, let's import something from LangChain/chains. And what we want is either the LLM chain, or we can use the conversation chain, which implies that we are dealing with a conversational application. So I'll just go with this one. Then down in our code, let's create our chain by setting it equal to new conversation chain. And this takes in a few inputs. First, we need to supply our model, which we called model. Then we need to enter our prompt, which we called prompt, so we can actually omit this. Then this class also allows us to add a memory property, and we also call this memory, so I'll simply omit this. And that is actually all we have to do using this method to add memory to our application. In order to demonstrate this in the best way possible, I'm actually going to sequentially call this chain several times, but of course, feel free to implement this solution where we call the model in a loop from the previous videos. For the first call, let's actually call this input 1, and I'll call this response 1, which takes in input 1, and let's console log response 1. Let's run this to see if it's still working, and indeed, this is still working. Let's change this to something like the passphrase is hello world. Now, also, in order to see what's actually happening to this memory, let's console log memory dot load memory variables. And this is an async function which we need to await. And you will notice that from this console log, we get this history object back, which is simply an empty string. Now let's simply copy this, let's paste it down here, and let's change this comment slightly to say something like updated history. Let's change it to input 2. For input 2, let's ask, what is the passphrase? Let's change this to response 2. Within invoke, let's pass in input 2. And lastly, let's console log response 2. Let's run this in the terminal. First, we can see that the history is just a blank string. Then we get our response back from the AI. Then we get our response back from the chain. Then we can see the updated history, which now contains a string that contains the human and AI messages. And this is injected into the prompt template, and therefore the model was able to provide the correct answer. This is cool, but this is not what you came here for. How do we now store this chat history in a persistent database? So LangChain actually offers integration with several chat memory providers. And in this video, we will have a look at storing our conversation data in an Upstash Redis-backed database. Don't worry about costs though, as Upstash offers a very generous free tier. And just a little side note, the LangChain documentation is fantastic for seeing exactly how to integrate with pretty much any provider. And we can see on this page that we do have to install a few dependencies. So let's simply copy all of this, and then in our terminal, let's paste that and press enter to install these dependencies. Now let's import Redis into our project. So just below buffer memory, I'll actually import something from @LangChain community /stores /LangChain. message/upstash redis. And from this, we want to import the upstash redis chat message history. And if you wonder where I got all of this from, I simply copy this from the documentation. Now we just need to instantiate this class. So just above memory, let's do that by calling const. I'll call it something like upstash chat history is equal to new upstash redis chat message history. And this takes in an object as input. And here we can specify a session ID. And this is simply a unique identifier for this conversation. So if we ever want to continue this conversation in the future, we simply have to pass in that same session ID. You can of course use packages to generate unique identifiers, but for this, let's simply call it chat1. Then let's also pass in this config property, which takes in an object, and this is a very simple object. It only requires two properties, a URL as well as a token. Now let's have a look at where we can get this URL and token from. Go over to upstash.com and then click on login to create your account. Then on this dashboard, select Redis at the top menu and then click on Create Database. Give your database a name. I'll just call mine LangChain.js and let's also select a region and let's click on Create. Now, if we scroll down with this page, we can see this REST API information over here. And this gives us our REST API URL as well as our token. So you can simply click on this copy button to copy this value and then paste it into this code. Then do the same for the token. But because this is sensitive information, I've decided to store these values in environment variables within this .env file. So I'll simply use the environment variables instead. This is all we have to do to instantiate this Upstash client. So all we have to do now is attach this to the buffer memory object somehow. And this is really easy. Buffer memory takes in a second property called chat history, which we can set equal to this upstash chat history. Now, watch what happens when we run this chat now. So let's run this in the terminal. And as expected, we do get our responses back. But if we now switch over to Upstash and click on Data Browser, we can now see that session, which I called chat1, as well as the conversation history. And to prove to you that this is working, let's scroll down to these messages and let's comment out input1 so that we are only left with this question, what is the passphrase? Let's run this again. And we can already see that the updated history contains the values that were stored in the Redis database, and therefore we get the correct response back. Now let me show you how you could build the solution using the newer LangChain expression language approach, or at least the Runnable Sequence class. First, let's comment out this chain, and we will create our chain within this LCEL block. So let's start by typing const chain, which is equal to something we haven't seen in the series yet. Let's start by importing something from LangChain. Let's import something from @LangChain/core/runnables. And what we want is something called a runnable sequence. Now, what a runnable sequence is if we put back the original code, this effectively is a runnable sequence. Prompt is an executable function which takes in an input, does some sort of processing, and returns an output. That output is then passed on to the next function in the chain, and this will do its own set of processing, produce some sort of output, and pass it along in the sequence. This runnable sequence class is just another way in which we can create these type of chains. But it also allows us to add our own functions in which we could do some sort of processing and then feed the output down the chain. So on this class, let's call .from, and we can now specify an array of values, and each of these values represent an executable. For instance, we already know we need our prompt first in the chain, and then lastly, our model. Now we can actually create our very own executable by starting it off with these curly braces, and we can then specify the outputs that this executable will produce, and we know that this executable needs to pass an input property into this prompt, right? When this chain is invoked, we will pass in this input value, and we don't want to lose this value. We simply want to pass it along in the chain. So let's add input as one of the outputs that this will produce. And now for each of these outputs, we can specify a function that needs to do some sort of processing and return a value. What we also receive is the output from the previous chain. And because this is the first executable in this list, we will simply receive the initial input, effectively this value over here. We don't want to change this. We simply want to pass it along so we can simply return initial input. And on this object, we have a property called input. That is what we call this property when we invoke the chain. However, I want to pass in my very own custom property. I'll just call it memory. You can call it whatever you want. This doesn't take in any input as we're not receiving this value from a previous executable. But in this function, I actually want to grab the values from my memory store. We are already getting those values in this console log. So I'm simply going to copy this code and paste it up here. Now when this chain executes, it will simply pass along the input value, but it will create a new property called memory, which will grab the conversation history from this method. Now, memory will be passed on to the next executable in the chain, which is prompt. But prompt isn't expecting a memory property. It's simply expecting two values, the input and, if we go to the prompt, another property called history. So let's add another executable. This will simply pass the input along. I'll actually call this previous output because we are fetching these values from this previous executable, and we can get the value of input from this object by calling previous output dot input. Now let's grab the value that this prompt expects. It is expecting a property called history. For this, let's also grab those previous outputs. And within previous output, we are returning this memory property. So on previous output dot memory, we want to grab the value that this class returned. And if we open our terminal, we can see that that property was called history. So on memory, let's call the history property, like so. I know this might seem a bit confusing, so please let me know in the comments if you would like a dedicated video on how Runnable Sequence works and how to use it. So this is a long-winded process of effectively grabbing the values from that memory store and then injecting it into our prompt. Let's actually add this back. And in order to test this, I'm actually going to delete the existing values in the database. So this session is now gone. And let's go ahead and run this. I can tell you now that it's not going to work, but I do want to show you what happens if we run this chain as is. So we are getting responses back from the chain, but we can see that this initial history is blank, which is correct. This is simply because we cleared the Redis database, but on the updated history down here, we can see that it's still blank. And that is because with this runnable approach, the buffer memory isn't being updated automatically. We actually do have to do that ourselves. We can do that by calling await memory.saveContext, and this takes in the input values as well as the output values. So for the input, we can simply pass in input 1, and for the output values, I'll pass in an object with a property called output, and this has a value of response1.content, and we can do the same thing for the next response. Let's simply change this to input 2. Let's change the output to response 2. Like so. Let's go ahead and run this again. So initially the history is a blank string. We can now see that the updated history does contain values and the chain was able to answer this question. And if we go back to Upstash, we can now see that session as well as the messages from our conversation. Now just for completeness sake, let's comment out this first request so that we are only left with this question, and let's run this again. And we can see that the history was fetched from Redis and our chain was able to answer the question.